The battle lines are drawn.
We can keep Australians safe and we can ensure we can deal with the cost of living pressures that they're facing right now.
We'll be out there campaigning to strengthen Medicare, for more secure work, for making more things here.
Arrows poised.
I'm not Scott Morrison. I don't run away from press conferences, OK?
But Albanese took the first hit, stumbling over the basics.
What's the national unemployment rate?
National unemployment rate at the moment is, I think it's 5.4. I'm not sure what it is.
Gotcha.
20 minutes later, the PM was ready to strike.
The unemployment rate, I'm happy to tell you, was 4% and is falling to a 50-year low.
The PM under fire over the status of his education minister.
He's done nothing wrong. Why is the taxpayer on the hook for hundreds of thousands of dollars to Rochelle Miller?
She's accused the former Liberal frontbencher of bullying her.
Is Alan Tudge still a cabinet minister? I'm a little confused.
He is still a minister. He has not resigned his commission, and nor has he been dismissed.
We had a situation whereby he stood down, but apparently he still got his job in the cabinet.
The PM was also forced to address this black summer blow-up.
We're never getting any votes down here, buddy. You're out, son. You are out.
The locals probably gave him the welcome that he probably deserved.
Look, that was a difficult day.
I'm not going to sit there as a wallflower. I'll call it how it is, and I care about the community that I've lived in for most of my life.
And while our fearless leaders duke it out day one, we took to the streets of Western Sydney to see what voters actually care about most.
When it comes to bushfires and floods, you know, just like payments and stuff to like help support everyone around us.
Cost of living.
Create more job opportunities.
The environment and climate change should be definitely up there for me.
Well, it's nice that it's finally been called.
What do you think about our current Prime Minister?
I don't really know who it is, to be honest.
Well, Labor MP Tanya Plibersek and Liberal MP Katie Allen join us once more as we've officially gotten underway in the election campaign. Thanks very much to both of you. Tanya, let me start with you and that gaffe from Anthony Albanese that has dominated headlines today. Do you think it's important that the alternative Prime Minister knows the cash rate and the national unemployment rate?
Well, election campaigns are a test of leadership. They're not a test of memory. Anthony's said that he should have known, but I think it's actually worth asking what sits underneath the unemployment rate as well. We've got right now about a million Australians who want more hours of work. They don't show up in the unemployment rate. So we've got a plan to deal with unemployment. Yes, we want to see full employment in Australia, but we also want to deal with insecure work. We want to deal with the fact that there's many Australians out there who are desperate for more hours of work who can't get them, who are working two or three or four jobs to try and make up one full-time pay packet. And the reason that they're struggling is because this government is quite happy for people to have low-paid, insecure work. They've said it themselves. Low wages are a design feature of their economic architecture. Labor, in contrast, wants to see secure work with decent wages.
OK, so I understand that point, and you're right, it's not a memory test, but I guess it comes down to, if you have a plan, as you've just described, I imagine people with a plan would have been pouring into these numbers for months, and it wouldn't be a thing where they have to remember it, because they would have just been quoting these things to each other for ages and delving into the numbers beneath them, and it would just be second nature by now. So I suppose the question is, how well do you know your own plan? Can Australians trust that you really are across it?
Well, 100%. I mean, we've got a plan to make sure that two people doing the same job get the same pay. Same job, same pay. We've got a plan to make sure that gig economy workers get paid decently, that casual work is properly defined. We want to make sure that secure employment is something that the Fair Work Commission focuses on when it's making its decisions. We've got a government that still has a 14% gender pay gap, and we know that there's much more that we could be doing to see women's wages go up. We've got a plan to make sure that companies above 250 staff, for example, disclose their gender pay gap publicly. I really think, Waleed, you know, if you talk to Australians in the street today, as I've been doing up here in Brisbane, what they're telling me is that the cost of everything is going up, but wages are not keeping pace with that. That's That's what they want an answer to. How are we going to fix this problem of low wages with rising cost of living?
Sure, Tanya, but look, it might have been a borderline gotcha question. But what if you'd been asked a more substantial question? What if you'd been asked to comment on where would you like the unemployment rate to be a year from now? If you didn't even know the starting point, how could you give a reasonable answer to that question?
Well, Barry, I think I can only say again, it's not a memory test. Election campaigns are about our plans for the future. We've got a government that has presided over historic low wages growth. What wages are actually going backwards under this government. The price of living's going up. We've got a plan to turn that around. We've got a plan to make sure that more Australians have more secure jobs, that when they work hard and the economy's going well, they actually see a pay rise.
Okay.
That's the difference that we can make in people's lives.
All right, Tanya, I understand that point. Katie, why is Alan Tudge still a minister?
Well, my understanding is he stepped aside from his duties and he's not being paid as a minister, but that he is fighting the next election and he's concentrating on his community.
But we've heard today that he hasn't resigned the position and no one else has been sworn into the role, so he's still a minister. Why?
I don't know the exact answer for that, other than to say that the facts are he has stepped aside from his role as a minister. The acting minister in his place has been Stuart Robert, and he has stepped aside. And in fact, he's no longer a minister in the actions of being a minister or being paid as a minister.
But he still gets to say he's a minister if someone asks him at a dinner party, and he still gets to ride in a car with a flag on the bonnet or something?
I suspect that's not the case. But at the end of the day, he's not acting as a minister. He's actually his duties. I've rung up Stuart Robert to talk about his role as acting Minister for Education. So from my point of view as a backbencher, I reach out to Stuart Robert when I've been talking and asking questions about the acting Minister for Education. That is Stuart Robert. So my understanding as a backbencher, the role of acting Minister for Education is Stuart Robert, and he has been performing those functions.
Katie, the Vice President of your party basically said if you lost, that would be no bad thing because the party would be rid of a lefty. Whose side is she on?
Well, I have to say that people say a lot of things, and for me, I'm about, you know, holding the seat of Higgins and working hard each and every day for the people of Higgins. And for me, you know, lots of people say lots of different things, but at the end of the day, getting the job done is what I'm doing, and doing it here in the seat of Higgins.
Can I just come back to the Alan Tudge thing? One of the things that's interesting about this is the idea of a payout to Rochelle Miller. We understand in the order of about $500,000. The PM wouldn't even confirm that this payout has happened. Because it was a private matter. But this is taxpayer money. Surely it's not a private matter. Surely we should know exactly what was paid and why.
Well, I don't actually know the details myself, so...
Shouldn't you, though? Isn't that the point?
Well, it's a matter for the department and it is a matter for the case that's before the department. I'm unaware of the negotiations or the arrangements with the department. So it is a matter to, you know, for the minister who is responsible for the department, and that would be, I'd say, the Minister for Finance, Simon Birmingham. So I'm unaware of what the details of that matter are.
Tanya, Katie, both your leaders were asked today what their weaknesses were. Let's take a look at their answers.
What do you see as your biggest weakness?
Well, I tend to go straight into problem-solving mode, Koshy.
What's your biggest weakness?
I think a weakness I've found is loyalty.
Some really raw and honest answers from both leaders there. Now, Tanya, without reverse psychology, what is Anthony Albanese's weakness?
Well, he's an all-round charming fellow. I couldn't think of a single way. I thought you were going to ask me my biggest weakness, and I was going to tell you that confession is good for the soul, but it's not good for the reputation. And I'll let other people work out what my weaknesses are.
Okay, Katie, what about Scott Morrison? Can you tell us one of his weaknesses?
Well, he's pretty determined, and I think when he wants to get something done, he really wants to get something done. So, you know, I think that's mostly a strength, but sometimes when people are determined, sometimes they can seem very stubborn, but that's a good habit to have when you really want to get something done.
We would have accepted ukulele.
Do we need to provide a definition of the word weakness?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the thesaurus needs to be sent.
Something like that. My weakness is I'm just too perfect.
It's like the Homer Simpson interview when he gets asked what his biggest weakness is and he says, oh, I steal stuff from work. I'm really slow at learning new stuff.
Yep. That's what we needed for the promo, Tanya. Thank you very much for providing it. And thank you to both of you for joining us tonight. We appreciate it. We'll see you
soon.
Thanks
so much.